Why don't you just talk to God for a moment and say, Lord, I don't mind waiting for your will. I don't mind waiting for your counsel for my life. I don't mind waiting to plug into your plan and purpose for my life. I don't mind waiting until that which you have said concerning me comes to pass. Lord, I don't mind waiting on you. I don't mind waiting for you. I don't mind waiting upon you. Even though it tarry, yet, Lord, I will wait. Give me the grace. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you because we know that your plans and your thoughts towards us, they are of good and not of evil, to give us a future and a hope, to bring us to an expected end. Sometimes, Lord, it seems that these plans are taking longer than we want before they become established in our lives. But this morning, Lord, we don't mind waiting, because we know that when you come, Lord, you come big. Lord, that when you come, Lord, you come with something that is permanent. Lord, that when you arrive with the best. Lord, we choose to wait. Give us the grace. Give us the strength in this journey of waiting on you. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, this morning speak to our hearts. Open the gates of our minds to that that comes from you, that shapes our future into the perfection of our destiny in you. And Lord, every other thing, Lord, that will make us to derail from your purpose, Father, shut the gates of our lives against it. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you, choir. God bless you. Hallelujah. Once again, welcome to church. This is our season of blossoming. And I hope you are blossoming already. The Lord started with us very well this year. And this month in particular, we are looking at keys to blossoming. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, it says, "For I know the thoughts that I have towards you." And NIV says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." NIV says, "Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." Hallelujah. If I'm permitted to rephrase that verse this morning, I will put it this way and say, for God knows the plans that he has for you. Plans to make you blossom. I said plans to make you blossom. I said plans to make you blossom and not to harm you and not to make your life a desert. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And that hope and a future is based on an end that God himself has put in place, because he's the one that sees the end from the beginning. where it's taking you to, you may not have a complete glimpse of it right now. Sometimes it may seem as if God is delaying. Sometimes it may seem as if the path that He wants you to take is not the popular route. Sometimes the path He wants you to take does not look logical because it's not the common road. But if you choose to follow Him, it will cause your path to blossom in the name of Jesus. As much as God has good plans and solid thoughts of good expectations for us, it's also important that we know this morning that the decisions that we take in our lives contribute to how we arrive at the destination. The decisions we take in our lives contribute to how fast or how slow it will take us to arrive at God's destination for our lives. And unfortunately, sometimes those decisions actually cause us to derail from God's plan. It does not mean that God's plan has changed, but we are taking decisions that have made us to go out of His way because we cannot see what God sees. My prayer is that the power to see beyond the physical, the Lord will give to you in the name of Jesus, so that your life will not be moved and directed by situations and circumstances around you, but by the plans and thoughts and ways of God in the name of Jesus. Now, because the decisions we make affect how we arrive at God's destination for our lives, or whether we even get there or not, it's important that we look at one of the gates that's very vital, that plays a key role in our decision-making process in life, and that is the gate of our mind. M-I-N-D. So I've topicked this message this morning, the gates of the mind. The gates of the mind. If you will truly blossom in line with God's plan, and you see, I keep emphasizing God's plan for you, because it's possible for you to blossom outside God's plan. And that's why the Bible says in the book of Proverbs that the blessings of the Lord, it maketh rich and addeth no sorrow to it. And you can turn it around and say the blessings that comes from the devil can also make rich, but it added sorrow. It does mean that it's possible to blossom in God, and it's possible to blossom outside God. The choice you make will help you in your path to blossoming. But take notes. If you choose to blossom outside God, there are grave consequences. But if you choose to stay in God, there are godly consequences. Hallelujah. Our mind is the seat of decision making. Assuming your life is a computer, then we can simply say that your mind is the central processing unit, the brain box of your computer system. The mind determines what goes into our hearts and sieves what comes out of it. Basically, every good deed or bad deed that proceeds out of our lives is an output that started its journey from the mind. Nothing happens by chance. At one point or the other, something must have passed through your mind that translates eventually into your actions or your inactions. That translates eventually into what you hold dear as values in life. That translates eventually into the kind of decisions that you make, especially at critical points of your life journey. When we were born, we came with a blank mind. And because the mind cannot be blank, something must fill it. And the world is designed to help us program our minds. And so, over the years, the mind gets programmed. That process makes us to become mentally conformed, socially conformed to the standards of the world, to the ways and behaviors that's promoted by the world system. And because the gates of our mind basically place that key role in the decisions we make in life, you find that when you look at your past, you have made certain decisions which, at the point at which you were making such decisions, you believed you were making the right decision. But now you know better. You look back and you ask yourself, I shouldn't have gone that route. But it also does happen that sometimes the point at which you are making the decision, you had a choice. And you decided to follow a particular path in your decision making based on certain factors that you considered very, very precious to you at that point in time. Perhaps you got born again along the line. And the point at which you got born again, something is expected to start happening. A process of reprogramming of the mind. And this is how it works. From your coming up as a toddler, you have several voices that speak into your life. Voices of men. And when I say men now, I mean male and female. I mean things created by men. Your parents, teachers when you go to school, neighbors that you grow up with, friends that become close to you or distance from you, relatives. Perhaps even the church that you have grown up in has influenced the programming of your mind. And so you find that you have a particular line of thoughts that when you hear something contrary, your mind does what? It repels it, because that's not the way your mind is programmed. And that's what has made some people come to a point, for example, where, as far as they are concerned, a man can marry a man. Their conscience does not even blink. Whereas, I want to assume that for most of us here, when you hear something like that, your mind repels it because you believe, no. Those guys are, they've gone wacko. But do you know that some of them used to be in the same position that you were? And then something happened. The programming of the mind. And that's where the devil comes in. Because if you're unfortunate to have found yourself in a place where the voices that speak into your life, directly or indirectly, the voices that program your life and the gates of your mind, if those voices are voices that they themselves are coming from the pit of hell, or their lives are being driven by things that come from the pit of hell, it's just a matter of time. Your mind gradually does what? Accepts those things as true. And so when it gets to the point in which you are going to make a decision in life, in business, in marriage, in your finances, where to live, what career you want to do, what kind of business you want to do, the kind of deals you want to make in businesses, what you have come to believe is right, generally influences your decision. And we call that your belief system. It has shaped your values. It has shaped what, you know, you see as right or wrong. And your belief system is influenced by what those voices that speak into your life perceive as truth. Truth can be absolute. It can be relative. When truth is relative, it means that based on environmental conditions and circumstances, something can be true today, but over time, it changes. But when truth is absolute, it does not matter from 1780 to 1880, 1880 to 1980, 1980 to 2016, go from Africa to America, go from America to the Middle East, go from the Middle East to Asia, that truth remains constant. The question this morning is, what truth has programmed your belief system in the gate of your mind, which now reflects on the kind of decisions that you make in your life now? Because those decisions will affect how you blossom, when you blossom, and if your blossoming will take you to God's destined plan and thoughts for your life. My prayer this morning is that at every junction in your life where you have to make decisions and take decisions, those decisions will not be based on the wrong values, in the name of Jesus. The moment you become born again, Romans 12 chapter 2, Apostle Paul said something there. Romans 12 chapter 2, he said, and do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may be able to prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. But be ye transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may be able to blossom in a way that is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that your blossoming may be good and acceptable and in God's perfect will. It's better not to blossom and make heaven than to blossom and find yourself not fulfilling God's purpose for your life. Apostle Paul was saying, in essence, dearly beloved, the gate of your mind, the CPU of your life, the central processing unit of your life needs to be reprogrammed, because it's your spirit that gets saved. It's your spirit man that is quickened at the new birth. Your mind, which operates in the realm of the soul, unfortunately, there is no push button that you can press that says clear, and all the stuff that's been programmed there over the years will just wipe off, like you are formatting a hard disk, and then you can reprogram. Apostle Paul says this transformation is a process. It's a journey. And that process is a process of reprogramming. You need to embark on that journey if you are yet to start. And in doing it, you need to find out what is God's expectation, not man's expectation. Because as good or goodly intention as a man may be, there is no man that is perfect. There is no man that knows it all. Unfortunately, there are certain voices that speak into our lives that we have come to respect very well, that we have come to place a lot of trust in whatever they say. So we don't even take time to check the Word of God and confirm if what they are saying actually is God's mind, or it's an imposition of their own former programming upon God's mind. Because unfortunately, you read the Bible sometimes, and even though you are seeing something different from what your mind has been programmed to be there, your mind keeps telling you that what you have always had is what you are seeing. Something else is telling you, can't you see that this is different from what you have always had? But the gate of the mind sometimes requires what I call software upgrade. Hallelujah. And the software upgrade means, yes, this is what I've always known, but is this scripture telling me something different? Let me find out more. What is it trying to tell me? What is other parts of the scripture trying to tell me? What does other part of the scripture say about this thing? And you begin to discover that what you have always thought the Bible says is actually not what the Bible says. Then you begin to tell yourself, what the Bible says is what is correct. What the Bible says is what is true, not what Pastor Agbaje said. Then you are ready to key in into God's plan for your life. The devil has taken advantage, or is taking advantage of technology so well. So when it comes to programming of the mind, talk about audiovisual media. The devil has taken very good advantage of it, up to the extent that the next generation, our own children, forget it. They are not thinking like you are thinking. They are not being, their minds is not being programmed by those things you are talking about in the house. Their minds are not being programmed by what they are seeing you doing. Their minds are being programmed by what they are being fed online 24 hours of the day. And the Lord will help us as a church, because it's a big challenge. And except we have victory over this, except the Lord is able to raise up for us men and women in this generation and the next that will also take hold of this technology and begin to write programs and softwares that depict the mind of God and write it in such a way that it's attractive to the mind of our children. There is no way that we are talking about sitting down in the church like this today. I'm not sure our children are thinking that way. I'm sure some of you that have teenagers already, you might begin to have a, you know, see how they are beginning to say, are we not tired of, you know, because for them, it's becoming boring. There are some other things that excite them. And you see, it's getting so bad that our younger children, and I've been asking myself a question, what else can we do differently? Because I'm not sure if I have younger children like that they will not be doing the same thing. I've been to some services, and what are our children doing? All of them are carrying tablets or phones. They are playing games, they are watching films. A lot of times those things, you know, look innocent. Very innocent. Oh, they are just playing games. Oh, they are just watching. Unfortunately, I'm not too good at all those things, the names. But do you know that a lot of those things have been programmed to program their minds? And they cannot hear what we are talking about. I think it was about 3 years ago, we were at a watch night service. And the girl that was sitting in front of me obviously was a teenager, not even a child. And from the beginning of that service till the end of that service, she was fully engrossed in watching films on this, right in the church. All that was happening, even when we were praying, she stood up, she was still here. When you say sit, she sits, she's still there. As she's doing that, you know, she's flipping, responding to WhatsApp messages, responding to BB messages, switching back to the film, up and down. And from the beginning of that message to the end of that message, I just shook my head. I said, God, have mercy. Because probably the parents were there. And the parents believed, oh, she was in church with us. But she was actually in America or Europe. Hallelujah. As adults, we watch African Magic. Oh, Magic, sorry. Okay, thank you. Your mind is here. It's not traveled yet. And thank God for this group called Mount Zion Ministry. But unfortunately, I don't think that group was encouraged by the church. I've seen several drama groups, you know, come up and they just fizzle out. Why? Because even for us believers, a lot of us would prefer to watch African magic than those Christian films. Why? Because the technology in those films, it doesn't match what Hollywood gives to us or Nollywood. So where is our own Nollywood in the church? Where is our own Hollywood in the church? The Lord will have mercy. In the name of Jesus. Programming of the mind. What is the software that is installed in your mind? Who installed it? What kind of upgrades do you get? Is it from Nollywood, Hollywood, Bollywood? Or is it from the Word of God? Do not be conformed to this world. I like the way Amplified Version puts it. Do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by the renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so that you may prove for yourselves what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in His plan and purpose for you. Regeneration of your mind. If you do not take hold of that gate and begin to control it by the help of the Holy Spirit through the Word of God, your journey to blossoming that is good and acceptable in line with God's perfect will be a long journey. I remember many years ago, I used to be in the office with an elderly man, and he obviously must have been a man that was frustrated in marriage. Because even without you asking him questions, he gives you free marriage counsel. Never trust a woman, no. A woman should never know how much you earn, no. I can't remember very well, but I think there must have been a way by which I must have, you know, respectfully approached him one day, because he was a very elderly person, and said to him, "Sorry, sir, all these things you talk about, I don't get it, because my marriage is different. My marriage operates on a different frequency." And I think after that, you know, we must have gotten into a lot of discussions. And he will always believe that, young man, it's just a matter of time, you don't understand. But I want to thank God that many, many years after, I still understand. I've just used that as a typical example. There are many people whose marriages cannot blossom simply because their minds have been wrongly programmed. Unfortunately, some have even gone for marriage programs and they've had pastors give them advices that are contrary to the word of God. Why? Because for such pastors, that is their experience. And they believe that that experience is the way it should be done. Can you make up your mind and say to yourself, I refuse to run my life based on another man's dictates? I refuse to run my life based on the programming of the world. I choose to reprogram my mind. Because the moment you choose to reprogram your mind, and you say, I'm going to go to the word of God, whatever the word of God says is what I will follow. You have begun the real process of blossoming that is good and acceptable to God. And with God on your side, you will arrive at your destination. In the name of Jesus. I say you will arrive at your destination. In the name of Jesus. I say you will arrive at your destination. God's ordained, expected destination for your life. In the name of Jesus. In closing, how much of mind reprogramming is taking place in your life? How much do you watch over the gate of your mind to refuse and to reject voices that are contrary to God's word in your business, in the way you do your business, in the way you run your marriage, in the way you deal with your spouse, in the way you deal with your children, in the way you run your finances, in the way you pray, in the way you live your life? Choose to deliberately, consciously reprogram and renew your mind. And when you start that journey, a process of transformation takes place. And then that scripture is fulfilled. You are no longer conformed to the standards of the world. You will blossom in the name of Jesus. Shall we pray? I want you to talk to God. You must have had something this morning. I don't know what it triggers in your mind. Let that dictate your conversation with God. Are you perhaps saying to God, Lord, my mind needs a reprogramming. Help me by your spirit to start that journey. Are you perhaps saying to God, Lord, the renewing of my mind is a journey that I've embarked upon already, but I'm still struggling. The things I want to do, I find it difficult because the flesh and the ways of the world, the standards of the world, makes it difficult for me not to conform. Are you perhaps saying to God this morning, Lord, I need your help. I just have to be reprogrammed. Or perhaps the Lord had dropped an idea in your mind of how to use technology to start development of softwares that will bring a reprogramming of the next generation in line with the Word of God. And you've been saying, Lord, how will it be possible? But you are saying, Lord, it's like you are confirming the word this morning. Now, Lord, I'm ready to go all the way. Or perhaps the Lord had been speaking to you privately. About what your purpose is for his kingdom. And somewhere in this morning's message, you caught it. And you are saying, Lord, show me the way. Or now I'm going to support and make this purpose come to reality. Father, hear the prayers of your children this morning. Father, hear the prayers of your children this morning. Cause the gates of their minds to begin to yield to the reprogramming that comes through your word. In the name of Jesus. I will just give an altar call quickly. You are not even born again. But you are religious. But now you understand the reason why, as religious as you are, it's difficult for you to obey God. And this morning you are saying, Lord, I want to surrender my life to you. I want my spirit man to be quickened, so that with the help of the Holy Spirit, I can embark on this journey of reprogramming of my mind, of the renewal of my mind, so that my life can be transformed. If you raise your hand above your head, I will just pray with you. You want to give your life to Jesus. If you raise it above your head, I will pray with you quickly. If you are raising it, let it be higher above your head. The Lord can see that hand, my sister. Why don't you say with me, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I cannot help myself. I acknowledge that my mind needs a reprogramming. I cannot help myself. I accept you, Jesus, into my life. Take your place in my heart. Give me your Holy Spirit. And with the help of your Spirit, open my eyes to understand your word. And give me grace to reprogram the gate of my mind, so that my life can align with that which is good and acceptable and your perfect will. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your daughter this morning. We ask, Lord, that as her name is written in the book of life, Lord, the grace run this race and run it to the fullest of the potential that is available. Lord, you will release unto her in the name of Jesus. Lord, for as many of us, O God, that are determining this morning to open the gate of our minds to the reprogramming that comes through your word, Lord, I pray that the grace to submit to your word and to obey your word and to put your word into practice, even when it is contrary to what the whole world is doing, Lord, you will give to them in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, help us in your church, in the church of Jesus, that the idea that we need, Lord, even to program the minds of our own children aright in line with your word, the resources that we need, and Lord, the support that we need, Lord, you will teach us even to get in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.